Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You may be seated. Anyone who has worked with children in any capacity, parenting, teaching, vacation Bible school, children's messages, working with children in any capacity knows that there's a move that you make, a trick, really, that you use when you're trying to drum up excitement in the people you're talking to. Let's say you're giving a children's message and you start with a question, but you don't exactly get the response that you're hoping for. My bet is that you make a comment something like this. Oh, you guys seem really tired today. Let's try that again. Or maybe it's something like, that was really weak. Let's try that one again. And you do this back and forth until either they rise to your level of excitement or they're shouting at the top of their lungs, or maybe just until you're satisfied with the answer. Whether it's a predictable move or not, it seems like it's the oldest trick in the book. Pastor Becker and I were having a conversation earlier this week, and I asked him, one pastor's kid to another, Pastor Becker, what do you remember about Easter as a kid with your dad? And he didn't really know where I was leading him with that question, but he indulged me, and he answered, well, about as soon as I learned how to play hymns on my trumpet, I started playing on Easter morning and serving in a variety of ways. But I responded to him, there's one thing above all else that I remember about my dad that is still true to this day about Easter morning. My sister Emily and I can always count on one thing happening. The service starts in the back of the sanctuary, and there's my dad. My dad loves, and I mean loves, to lead the congregation in our favorite Easter proclamation, Christ is risen. Hallelujah. That's right. But maybe it's the old wily Marine in him that is having flashbacks to all the oohs he used to say. Or maybe it's just the oldest trick in the book coming back around again. But we would say Christ is risen not once, not twice, but three times. And by that third time, if you looked really closely at him, you could see that vein in his neck looked like it was about to absolutely burst by how loud he was shouting those words. He would get everyone to rise to his level of excitement about that Easter greeting. It was like he wanted to recreate that first announcement that Jesus was risen that was given to the disciples or something. Truly beautiful words. In our epistle reading this morning, Peter is doing something very similar. He's writing a letter to Christians who need encouragement. These Christians are probably being persecuted for their Christian faith, and he starts out a lot like we do after Easter with a greeting that sums up all of the important parts of that Easter message, that Christ is risen, and because of it, death no longer has any power over Jesus or over those who believe in him. And because of that, we have a living hope. He's telling these Christians that they can rejoice because Jesus has been raised from the dead, and they now have an eternal inheritance that's already prepared that Jesus is guarding and protecting for them in heaven. This inheritance, it's now imperishable, unfading. It'll never go away or change because Jesus, the one who overcame death, is the one guarding it for them. What awesome words. But if we have a new hope, this living hope that we have now, it seems like Peter is alluding to the fact that it wasn't always that way. It's at this point that it's helpful to look back only a week removed from Easter and Holy Week to think about exactly what happened in that time. We think back to Palm Sunday and we shouted Hosanna on that day. On Maundy Thursday, we heard that new commandment that Jesus gives, that mandate on Maundy Thursday. We shouted, crucify him on Friday, and we shouted, Christ is risen on Sunday. We've been put through the emotional and the spiritual ringer. Such a wide variety of experiences and emotions packed into such a small period of time. So we return to the question, with those days in mind, what was our former hope? That somehow, broken and sinful people that we are, could do enough to please Almighty God that somehow he wouldn't dole out the punishment for the sins that we all knowingly and unknowingly commit, even up to this day and this very hour. All too often, we don't meet that standard that God sets for our lives. It becomes painfully obvious that we can never live up to that standard. We can't approach God in our sinfulness, let alone do anything to please him with our good works or our piety. Our hope was dead. Our inheritance was death. Eternal death and hell was our reward for our lives on earth. That's why those very last words of Jesus on the cross, "It is finished," ring so sweetly in our ears. Even though it required the death of Jesus, we know that by his death on Good Friday, Jesus took all of the punishment that we deserved onto himself and took it to the grave with him. That still doesn't paint a very nice picture of human life, though. We're all too familiar with the trials and the troubles of being human beings in this broken and sinful world. Just this week on Thursday, Pastor Schultz and I went together to the same hospital in the afternoon because of the sheer number of people from our congregation that we had at that one hospital either in surgery or receiving care in the same place, not to mention the other three or four hospitals in the area. Just yesterday, Pastor Becker led a memorial service for one in our church family who's gone too soon. Disease, cancer, frailty, they're all too common and they're all around us. They're inescapable. As we walk through life, if our hope were dead, then we'd be left to wonder what the purpose of life even is. Why are we here and why does it matter? We'd be like Thomas, who, rather than believing the good news about the risen Jesus, said instead that unless he touched Jesus with his own two hands, put his hand in his side, and saw Jesus with his own two eyes, he'd never believe it. Thomas was stuck in his dead hope. And Peter doesn't mince words about the reality of life in his greeting either. He acknowledges that even though things are not how God designed them, though things are not necessarily going according to that divine plan from the beginning, it might be necessary now for a short while to have our faith tested and tried. Just like the impurities in gold are purified, burned out by fire, so too our trials and troubles force us to look back to our living hope. They force us to rely on Jesus in the best and the worst circumstances of life. Peter knows this, which is why he says in that very same verse that he talks about troubles and trials that we can rejoice in the midst of them anyway. Now, if that sounds a little backwards to you, consider this. Rejoicing doesn't mean that we have a euphoric, happy all the time, naive sort of attitude that doesn't realize or isn't realistic about the trials and the troubles that we go through as human people. No, rejoicing as Easter people on this side of Easter means that we have an anticipatory joy, a joy that anticipates what's to come, a joy that looks to the future confidently, knowing the security that we have in the risen Jesus. It's not being buffeted by the circumstances of this life because of that certainty we have in Jesus. I was truly inspired this week as I sat with a member in the hospital while his wife was undergoing surgery. And I noticed as we were talking that he had a cross in his front pocket that looked like it was made out of palm fronds. And so I asked him about it. I asked what that meant or what that was. And he said that as they were leaving the house that morning to come to the hospital for surgery, he noticed it sitting on the cabinet in their home. And he picked it up thinking that maybe his wife could hold it in her hand as she's rolled back for surgery or keep it in her hand during the operation. And when they were told that that wasn't going to be possible, he put it in his pocket and on he went with his day. But there I was in the hospital walking up to him, greeting him as he had a smile on his face and a cross in his pocket while his wife is undergoing surgery. And I knew in that moment what living hope in the life of a Christian looks like. So you see, there's so much more than just happy thoughts or words when we say Christ is risen. Like Peter, we're telling each other once again what the cause of our hope is. We have a God who conquered death, the very thing that we could not escape ourselves. And a God who promises that for those who place their trust in him, he's already prepared and is guarding an eternal inheritance for each of us. This living hope, though, it's not some abstract thing that we can't see with our eyes. No, we can't see it at this exact moment. But we know that the reality is that by rising from the dead, Jesus, who once became our dead hope, is now our living hope on this side of Easter. He's the one our hope is in, and he's alive. We know for certain as Christians that on the last day, Jesus will call us forth from our graves and usher us into that eternal inheritance that he's already prepared for each of us. We know that because Jesus lives and promises us that where he is, we will be also. We have a sure and living hope, even though we do experience trials and troubles in this life. Our hope's name is Christ Jesus. He tells us he loves us, and he shows us the same by his death on the cross and his resurrection on Easter morning. So when the troubles of this life come around, when you sit in that hospital room either receiving or giving care to a loved one or a family member, when you're feeling the weight of your sin press upon your shoulders, when your guilty conscience is screaming in your ears and you feel the devil's hot breath on the back of your neck, you proclaim these beautiful words to yourself and those around you: Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. May the confidence that our living hope, Jesus Christ, gives be and remain with you always. Amen.